Hey there. Today, I'm thrilled to be bringing you this show with Mark Mancina, who has composed the music for so many classic films, including quite a few with Disney. You're listening to the Tomorrow Society podcast. Thanks so much for joining me here on episode 55 of the Tomorrow Society podcast. I am your host, Dan Heaton. It's easy to take movie soundtracks for granted. When you look at Disney films, some of them have songs that we hear repeatedly, and they just sort of become part of the zeitgeist. You don't think that much about what you're hearing, especially when you have kids. My youngest daughter constantly will play certain soundtracks to a point where I barely hear them anymore. They're just there. A little while back, I was driving with my daughter and we had the Moana soundtrack on. And she was being quiet in the back and just looking out the window. And I listened closer than I usually do. And I like the songs a lot, but it really hit me. These songs are brilliant. This is one of the best soundtracks Disney's done in years. Because I took the time to really think about the songs and dig further than just the enjoyment in the movies. And I mentioned Moana because the composer of a lot of that music, particularly the score, was Mark Mancina, who is my guest today on the podcast. And Moana is just one of many scores he's done. Mark worked on action films like Speed and Twister and Training Day. He's worked on Disney films. He works on the Plains films and Tarzan, Brother Bear. There are so many, including The Lion King, that he's been involved with. So it was really exciting to get to learn more about his story and how these films came together and some of the challenges in putting together scores for these soundtracks that almost feel magical, like they just appear with the movie. And of course, it is not that simple. So I loved hearing from Mark about some of the tricks and hurdles that you have to overcome to finalize a movie soundtrack. It takes an immense level of talent and organization to be able to connect that so well with what happens on the screen. Because we see it when it doesn't work out. The movies just don't click without good music. So let's go talk to him. Let's hear from Mark Mancina. Okay, well, my guest today has composed the scores for many films and TV series, including Speed, Training Day, and Twister. He's also worked frequently with Disney on music for Tarzan, The Haunted Mansion, and Moana most recently. He also did songs for The Rivers of Light nighttime show at the Animal Kingdom. It is Mark Mancina. Mark, thanks so much for doing the podcast.
Thanks for saying my name correctly.
I do my research. I try my best.
All right. Thank you.
All right. So before we dive into the specific work, I'd love to learn more just about your background. How did you get interested in composing music?
You know, I'm one of the lucky ones that knew exactly what I wanted to do when I was really, really young, as far as writing music goes. I always, when I would pick up an instrument, I would tend to want to write something rather than learn necessarily, you know, with a book or something like that, you know. I took lessons and I did all those different things, but I almost always would sit at the piano or sit with a guitar and write something rather than want to learn somebody else's stuff.
How early on from there did you think, I want to write for films and TV and entertainment versus writing, you know, your own compositions for other mediums?
Well, I never thought about film work through high school. I always thought that films would be really a cool thing to do when you're old, you know. I don't know why I would associate that, but I think it was probably just because when you would see film composers in those days, they would always be pretty gray, you know, and you would just think, wow, that's a pretty dignified job. But I never really aimed to work in film or television or any of that. I was really trying to figure out how to get paid to write music. I had no idea how you could possibly do that, but I tried just about every avenue I could think of, mostly songwriting, you know. It evolved into film opportunities.
Right. So you mentioned songwriting. Did you have, like, I know you've worked with some rock musicians and such. Did you have an interest in becoming playing in a band full time?
I did. You know, I played in a band from fourth grade until I was 31. And I played pretty much close to 5 to 6 nights a week starting when I was 20. And I was in several bands, but all of them were really pretty good, and they were all mostly original stuff. And then, of course, to eat, we'd have to play top 40 and whatever was happening. But I was really fortunate because in the early 80s and mid 80s, there was an avenue of playing music and getting paid, but playing whatever you wanted. So my band, we would play Genesis and we would play Peter Gabriel stuff. You know, we'd play really, really interesting stuff and get paid for it, and people wanted to come and listen to us. And so it was like learning stuff that I probably wouldn't have learned, like Steely Dan and stuff like that, but I had to learn it because we played it. So it kind of took me into all different areas of music that I otherwise would have never visited.
So how much do you think all of that, especially like those early rock bands, I mean, early for the 80s and such, how much did that influence how you brought your style in when you started composing for movies?
Well, for sure. I mean, I think that what changed for me was in 1971, right around that period where the Beatles were done and you had people expanding kind of on the Beatles' later work. So you had groups like King Crimson and early Genesis and Yes and PFM and Jethro Tull, all these guys that were groups that were coming out that were expanding upon the idea that writing a pop song wasn't just about the mating ritual. It could also be about all sorts of bizarre things. And a song could be 45 minutes long, and all that kind of opened up the rock world for me, because I never was much of a, you know, Eagles and that kind of stuff. That was never kind of music that I gravitated towards. The more complex stuff I really liked. So I think especially when I had the chance to do Speed, you know, I used Alan Holdsworth on that movie, and he was a big progressive rock guitar player, an amazing, amazing guitarist that not a lot of people for some reason know, but that all came out of the progressive rock era. So I was really kind of influenced by that.
Well, that's interesting, because Speed, as far as action films go, felt like it sounded different than a lot of movies that came before it. So, you know, you've done a lot of action movies like that and over your career, some very early on, low budget, but then further on. How much did you bring a lot of that prog rock as you went along through some of the other action work you did?
I think so, yeah. And I think especially if you listen to the overture to Speed, that was so great that we got to do you know, the movie opens with music, right, for 3 minutes or whatever it is. And I got to write that after I had pretty much figured out all the themes and had it going. And that was like writing a little 3-minute progressive rock piece, really, for me, you know. I brought it into other work. And it's funny that I've ended up working with those guys. I produced Emerson, Lake & Palmer and wrote with them. I worked with Yes and wrote with them and produced them. I worked with Phil Collins. I mean, it's weird that all came back around somehow.
That's interesting, especially given that, you know, you work with Phil Collins on some Disney projects. When you work with someone like Phil Collins or others like that on even a project that's very different, does that make it easier to connect with like Phil on Tarzan, for example? Was that easier to connect with him?
It totally was, because I, you know, like he sent me what I got on Tarzan was I got his demo of You'll Be in My Heart. They needed it to fit into the story of Tarzan. And so I worked like I always worked with Elton John stuff on Lion King too. I just basically erased the demo and kept the vocal, you know, and arranged around the vocal. And so I did that with You'll Be in My Heart. And sent it to Phil, and he absolutely loved it. And I think he loved it because we came, you know, our backgrounds are similar. And I listened to him growing up and his band, and I knew his style and I knew it really well. And so it was really somewhat second nature for me to kind of get into working with him and doing stuff together. It felt really comfortable. We worked for a long time because we did two movies almost in a row, you know, and those animated movies are forever. So they were, you know, it's like 7 years or so working together. So it was really pretty fun.
Yeah, it's interesting because I think of that song and compare it to, like, I would never have known that you did that because you listen to it and you say, that sounds like a Phil Collins song, especially more recent stuff, or that sounds like Elton John. So I think that made a huge difference because...
Well, I didn't write it. You know, he really had his thing. I mean, Phil has a thing that's undeniable. It just was that... I was able to wrap music around him that he was really comfortable with. And he didn't feel like, whoa, where are you going with this, man? I don't do this kind of thing. I mean, I did throw a few things at him at one point. We did a song for Brother Bear, and I had the guy that played harmonica. Gosh, I can't think. Oh, Tommy Morgan, who played on, you know, Green Acres and, I mean, everything, you know, and Beach Boys albums. And I had him bring in all these harmonicas and put these bass harmonicas and stuff on one of Phil's songs. And he was kind of looking at me a little bit like, what are you doing here, you know? For the most part, everything that I worked on with Phil, or I'd come up with a section, or I'd come up with a part of something, or and play it for him, he generally would love it because it was right down the line of what he was sort of used to. And I'm a huge Tony Banks fan, and so I knew that style really quite well, and they've worked together for many, many years. So I felt real comfortable working with them.
I want to circle back a bit, you know, because my focus a lot with this podcast is Disney and such. So I'm curious, you know, you started out, you worked on The Lion King, the film first version. How did you get started working with Disney on that project?
It was kind of two different ways. You know, one way was that I had a little bit of a relationship with Chris Montan, who was the head of music for Disney for many, many years, especially for their comeback. You know, when they kind of came back with these great Little Mermaid and Beauty and the Beast and those movies and Lion King. And he was kind of steering that ship in the music department. I had met him a few times, so he knew of me. And then I was working with Hans on stuff that Hans was doing, and he was telling me about this little lion movie that he was going to do, and that he needed basically kind of, let's, you know, why don't you do the songs and I'm going to do the score. I mean, we started off with Circle of Life together, but, and I think he did Be Prepared. And then I grabbed Can't Wait to Be King. And those songs weren't really working at that point with the directors. The songs weren't working well because they were not African at all, and they didn't fit into the story. But again, I felt really comfortable going into it. They didn't have any idea who I was, of course. Hans asked me to come into it, and I came into it, and I just started working on stuff and writing stuff and going into the studio and recording with people. And we developed those songs, and they became somewhat iconic. I mean, Hakuna Matata, who doesn't know that song, I guess, right?
Yeah, it's crazy because you think of all those movies that came at that time, but The Lion King, especially given the Broadway musical that I know you were very closely involved in, and the live action movie they're going to do. I mean, that one has held up so well over the years, and a lot of it is the music. So you mentioned Hans Zimmer, who worked on the music also.
Oh, yeah.
How are you? I mean, so you knew him from before that? You'd work with him regularly?
Well, again, you know, this is one of those weird things. The reason I met him was I was recording my own songs in LA with a producer, and he brought in an engineer to mix my songs. And the engineer he brought in was a guy named Jay Rifkin, who was Hans Zimmer's partner. When Jay heard my songs, he said, do you have any instrumental stuff? Do you write anything to picture or any kind of thing like that? And I'm like, yeah, of course. I've done documentaries. I've done all sorts of things. And I gave him a 3-demo cassette tape. And the next day I got a call from Hans, and he said, come on into the studio. And I went in, and I started working with Billy Idol and working on Days of Thunder, I think it was, or True Romance or something. I can't remember what we did, but we just started doing stuff together. It was really fun, really fun.
That's crazy how things work out that way, where, you know, just the right, you're in the right place at the right time, and it changes your
whole
career.
Well, of course, you know, I was probably 30 at that point or whatever I was. And I mean, then I moved to England. I lived with Emerson, Lake and Palmer for a year. I mean, things went all different directions, but that came back around, that relationship with him, with Hans, and then, of course, with The Lion King. And then by The Lion King, Hans went to DreamWorks. And because I had worked so closely with Disney on Lion King, you know, they really knew me at that point and had a lot of trust in me. So when the Lion King musical came up, I was their first go-to, you know. And I think then with Tarzan and those movies, it just seemed to fit, and everything, you know, rolled on, and it's been a really, really great relationship with them.
Yeah, especially with that musical, because now it seems kind of commonplace that there's a lot of movies that become musicals, like the other direction, but it was not that way when The Lion King came out, especially with Disney films. So how challenging was it to convert music or create new music, I know you did, for that musical?
It was very challenging. It was very challenging because it's a very complicated theater is a very complicated process anyway, but this theater was extremely complicated because I had to put together a band that could play pop music like Elton John songs, but it could also play orchestral music, could also play African influenced music. Julie Taymor really wanted to be very true to Africa and use real African instruments. And all of those things sound really delicious and great, but when you get in there and start working on it and you've got Hakuna Matata, you know, it's definitely a difficult concept. It took a long time, and I really had to take a break from Hollywood and from movies. And I was kind of at a really good point. I had a lot of hit movies and I was making really great money. But to do this, I really had to go away and go to Minnesota and go to New York a lot and really kind of live in a theater world, which is very different. So it was very valuable and wonderful to have done, but it did kind of stall out my movie career a bit, because I really, you know, as soon as you leave, they forget about you and they don't, you know, you're not the next best thing at that point. So it was kind of difficult getting back into it.
How were you able to kind of get over that and basically get back into movies? Because you've done a lot of big movies even since that point, obviously.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, I don't know that answer to that. I mean, all I can tell you is it's such a strange business. It's so unpredictable. Antoine Fuqua had gotten a hold of me and we did a movie called Bait. And then he couldn't wait to start Training Day. And we did that, and that did incredible. And that the music to that movie was very influential to a lot of projects. But interestingly, I didn't work with Antoine again after that until Shooter. And then we did Shooter together, and then I've never really heard from him again. So it's just a strange business. You just don't know where things are going to happen and when things are going to happen and how they'll happen. It's very weird.
Yeah, and I'm sure you have to be really flexible about it, because, like you said with Antoine, is that you worked on something. Training Day was a huge hit. I mean, Oscar winning for Denzel Washington. Like you mentioned, that music was everywhere. But then who knows? Who knows why it went from there? So that's really interesting.
It's very weird. You just never know. And so it's been an interesting career. It's never been in one place. It's always moved around. It's been very, very exciting.
Around that time, I mean, in 2003, you did the score for Disney's adaptation of The Haunted Mansion with Eddie Murphy. That music is interesting, of course, because you're converting it. Well, not converting, but there's source music already for the attraction. You're kind of creating something new. So what was that like, kind of creating something new, but also using some of that material as guidance?
Well, again, you know, I've had experience at that. If you look at Lion King, you know, taking Elton's songs and Elton and Tim's songs and then kind of turning them into not score, but certainly a setting that fits the music, but fits in with the film. And then working on Tarzan and working with some of Phil's themes and my themes and combining them and all of that. So it really kind of came second nature. I love the Haunted Mansion themes. And again, you know, I was working with a great director, Rob Minkoff, and a great producer, Don Hahn, who I had done The Lion King with. So I was working with real familiar people who love music. And, you know, we're willing to go different ways with the music and try different things. And it just makes it really fun and really freeing.
Yeah, well, I think that music, I watched the movie in recently, the music is great. I mean, it drives the story. So, and it feels a lot more epic. It's like you have the attraction music, but this is kind of, I mean, it sounds like you had a giant orchestra to put this together.
Yeah, we did. Again, you know, because Rob was the director, he really supported what I needed. And, you know, we had a choir, we had a huge orchestra, and we did it at Sony, which is my favorite place to record. And so it was, I really loved doing it. Unfortunately, the movie didn't do that well. And it wasn't, it was a bit messy. The picture itself, I thought the music turned out really, really great. And I still listen to it. I think it sounds really good too.
Yeah, it's good. I saw that there fairly recently, there was a few years ago, the soundtrack was released in kind of this double CD edition. And I'm sure that had to be rewarding because it wasn't something that I believe was out originally.
Yeah, a lot of my stuff doesn't get released. I don't know why that is. It's just the way it is. So I get emails all the time for people that want Bad Boys. I mean, Bad Boys, how old is that, you know? But I still get that.
Yeah, that's interesting, too, from that time, too, when CDs were selling like crazy. I could see it happening more now a bit.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just the way it was, way it worked.
Yeah, well, I also wanted to ask you about your most recent Disney project that you did, which was Moana, which for me is one of my favorite scores I've heard in a long time because it brings that island culture in and seems to fit the movie so well. But what was it like to work on that score?
It was really great. It was really hard. Really hard score. It was exciting to work in that framework because I'm not a Polynesian music expert of any kind, but I went to New Zealand and I listened to tons of groups over there. I listened to lots of music. I worked with Opetaiai here in my studio working on all sorts of stuff. Lin-Manuel was incredible. He was great. And all of that was wonderful. But really, when it came time to really put the score to picture, it was really tough because there was so much music and so specific. And really, I was left to it. You know, I mean, it was really myself and Dave Metzger sorting through so much stuff that we had worked on and written. And, and I was involved in that movie as the score writer, but I was also a co-songwriter and co-producer of the songs. So all of the songs came through me and all of the score came through me in my studio. And so I had to put all the finishing touches on everything. It was a huge, huge project, but I'm really proud of it. I'm really proud of it. I think it's a beautiful film, and the people I worked with were really great, so I have no complaints.
How long did you work on that? You mentioned it was hard.
Got to be 3.5 years, I think.
Wow.
It was definitely three. You know, a lot of people think that the Disney movies that they come in with, like Moana, and they have a script and a story, and then they animate it, and then you score it. But it's just so not like that. Moana was an idea that we started working on when we started, and it became over the years, the story would change and change and change and change. And the grandma's dead at the beginning. The grandma's not dead. There is no grandma. I mean, you go everywhere and you score ideas in your head that you're thinking that could happen that aren't there yet. And it's really a long and arduous process, but it's the reason why John Lasseter makes great movies. I mean, he very rarely misses on anything because he takes that kind of time and that kind of sensitivity when he comes into a project. So for me, it was a great privilege, really.
Yeah, and that's something because they come out, it's almost like magic when those films come out. It's like, wow, that's amazing. But
yeah.
I can imagine the way you're describing it, it sounds difficult for every level of the movie, but especially to compose songs. I mean, how were you able to keep it all straight, like, you know, in your head and with which themes you were doing?
It was really tough. I just, you know, I have a great person who runs my studio, Marlon, and he runs my studio. And then I have Dave Metzger, who's a great orchestrator. And that was it. You know, I don't have 17 people, you know, doing my stuff. So, I mean, you know, it was a tremendous amount of work, but our fingerprints are on every single note of that thing. So when it turns out really well like that, you feel like that's a job well done. So it was definitely worth doing, but it was really, I can't not say it wasn't extremely hard. Probably one of the hardest things I've ever done. That, and I would say the Lion King musical were probably the hardest things.
Well, I think though that work shows up because you can tell the music feels like someone spent years working on it. In a way. So I know you mentioned Lin-Manuel Miranda and Opetaiai,
yeah.
And I mean, there's shots even on the Blu-ray of the three of you just kind of working through these songs together. And that was when you started, it was pre-Hamilton explosion and everything.
Yeah.
So what was it like to work with both guys being so talented and having such different mentalities?
Well, you know, for one thing, we got along really well because all three of us are songwriters. So thank God, because there's a different, some people call themselves a songwriter, but they haven't really written that many songs. Lin is a songwriter, Opetaiai is a songwriter, and I'm a songwriter. We've written hundreds and hundreds of songs. So we really could relate to each other on that level. And so it wasn't competitive, and it wasn't anything other than inspiring because we couldn't really do what each other did. I can't do what Lin does. I mean, his lyrics and his ability to come up with storytelling is incredible. Opetaiai, of course, with his whole Polynesian bend on everything was like, give me a break. The guy knew the culture and could chant and sing all sorts of ideas that we would have never come up with. And of course, what I do is something that those two guys don't and can't do. So it was a really great combination. I have to hand it to, I guess it was probably Chris Montan at that time and Tom McDougall for thinking that that would work, you know, because that's a strange combination of people. I mean, one guy from New York who's a theater guy and one guy who's a score person, basically, and another guy who's a Polynesian singer, folk singer guy.
Yeah,
that could have been disastrous in some respects, but it really worked out great. It's just that Lin became so famous so quickly, and that thing just, Hamilton exploded, and it just made it more difficult to be together because he was so in demand, and his schedule and everything became difficult. But, you know, he delivered on everything, so, I mean, he did his thing.
Yeah, I can imagine that would be challenging, but like you mentioned, it's an inspired pairing because you think of songs like We Know the Way and stuff where everything kind of merges together in this new way that I don't even know what exactly type of music to call it.
You know, We Know the Way. I mean, that's a really good example because we did that here in Carmel. I think we had a meeting in LA and then they flew us back here where I live. But the other guys, of course, we sat here in the studio with this idea that Opetaiai had. Lin ran over and scratched some lyrics down quickly and we went into my studio, and Lin laid down the vocal idea, and that's the finished product. I mean, that's what you hear in the movie. And that was done here very early on, and it just was so inspired, and so it just came together so nicely that we kept it. And those are the kind of things I wanted to do a lot more of that, and we couldn't because Lin couldn't, you know, he couldn't be here for 3 days or 4 days. He didn't have that kind of time, and he couldn't, you know, travel across the country when he was in the middle of everything else. So it was just a little bit harder to do those things. We still came up with some really great things, but we weren't able to just sit and experiment like we were doing on that.
Right. I think it's hard to say what's the best song on that soundtrack, but that one, you can really feel the collaboration when you hear it all come together. I know we're going to finish soon, but I wanted to quickly ask a few things about the theme parks and things you worked on. The show Rivers of Light, I know that Don Harper was very involved with that show, but that you were involved in writing several songs at least for that. So what was kind of your experience working on that nighttime show at the Animal Kingdom?
Well, I started, gosh, man, that was, I think this is back in Moana time, and I had no idea really how long that project was going to go on. I thought it was, you know, something I would do because I've done other things for them. I did the Walt Disney Resort in Hawaii with a great Hawaiian ancient tribal singer, and I've done other things for them like that, but this thing went on for a really long time, the Rivers of Light. So I started by writing the song, which is kind of the main theme of the show. Dave and I, Metzger and I, worked on it quite a bit and wrote a lot of stuff. And then kind of what happened is I got really sucked into Moana, and Moana started to get so heavy that we just couldn't complete Rivers of Light. And we knew Don, who we've worked with for years. I mean, Don and I have worked together forever. We knew Don could take over and really put it together, and which he did. That was kind of my relationship on that. It was very busy at the beginning of it. And then, as I said, I kind of got sucked into Moana land.
After what you just said about Moana, I can't imagine doing another project really at the same time. But and Rivers of Light was supposed to open 2016, then became 2017. So I'm sure that finally opened, and I think it's great. But it was definitely another one of those projects that I think took a lot longer than expected. And you mentioned that music from Alani, which is great.
Alani, yeah, really.
I haven't been there yet, but I've heard the music. And how did you get involved working on that?
You know, again, Chris Montan called me and said, I've got this really weird project where you would get together with this Hawaiian singer and create songs together, and then the songs would play in a resort. And the way that they did it with the speaker system is you hear instrumentally the music outside. As you come in, you start to hear the vocals. And so it was just a strange project, and it ended up being really fun. I got to work with K-L-E-E, and that was amazing, and we did some great recording together, and we wrote together, and again, it was kind of a meeting of two people that probably would never have worked together, but ended up okay.
That seems to be kind of a through line through a lot of your career, is just working with a lot of different types of artists and finding a way to make something good.
Well, that's what, you know, I'm currently doing a musical that opens in Chicago in April, and it's the same thing. It's August Rush, which I did years ago, but you know, I'm working with a book writer, and, you know, it's a different world, you know, and it's exciting because it's not another movie. It's not a motion picture. It's a different medium, but yet it's music and it's creating and it's writing and it has all those hallmarks. So it's exciting.
Well, that sounds great. And I know you worked on the August Rush originally on the movie. So this is another case where you're kind of converting something to a new format, I guess.
Yeah. And this one's really challenging because in August Rush, it all has to be told with songs in theater. In August Rush, the movie, there was a lot of, you know, silence and just looking and visual art. But in theater, you got to kind of keep the storytelling going. So it has its own challenges. So it's another toughie.
Well, this has been great, Mark. Are there any other projects you're looking to in the future or that you're currently working on that you wanted to mention?
Well, not really. I mean, I think that Lin and I have been talking about another project together that looks like we're going to do. So that's really exciting. And I don't know, you know, the status of John Lasseter right now, because I'm not sure what his plan is since he left Pixar. But I've done 3 movies with him and I really, really, really loved it. They came out great. And I think he loved working with me. So I'm hoping that we do something else in the future because I really, really enjoyed working with him.
Okay, well, the collaborations in the future, especially with Lin, sound amazing, and good luck with all that, and I really appreciate you being on the podcast.
My pleasure, Dan. Thank you.
Well, that was great. I'd like to give a quick thanks to Mark for taking the time to speak with me on this show, and to Marlon, who runs his studio, for helping to set up this podcast. If you enjoyed this podcast, you should check out my interviews with Paul Leonard Morgan about the score for Test Track, and with Bruce Broughton, who has written music for so many Disney attractions like Ellen's Energy Adventure, The Making of Me, and Spaceship Earth. If you'd like to get in touch with me, you can send me an email, dan@tomorrowsociety.com. You can contact me on Twitter @TomorrowSOC or Facebook, Instagram, or Pinterest @TomorrowSociety. If you'd like to help support this show, a great way to do so is through reviews on Apple Podcasts or your other podcast providers, including Spotify, where you can also now listen to the show. The Tomorrow Society podcast is hosted, produced, and edited by Dan Heaton. The music is written by Adam Hookey and performed by the Sophisticated Babies. Thanks to everyone for listening and for all the support. I really appreciate it, and it totally helps for me to be able to speak with such talented guests like Mark. Next time, I will be speaking with AJ Wolf of the Disney Food Blog. She is back to talk about underrated dining locations at Walt Disney World. I can't wait. I will talk to you again very soon.